From Haynes to the Hummer, the history of the automobile in Indiana is a chrome-plated beauty supercharged with the Hoosier spirit. We celebrate 100 years of automotive history next on this special edition of Across Indiana.
Financial support for this special edition of Across Indiana is generously provided by the Indiana Historical Society, a nonprofit membership organization working since 1830 to promote awareness and appreciation of our Hoosier history, and the Indianapolis Motor Speedway Hall of Fame Museum.
Welcome to a very special edition of Across Indiana. I'm Michael Atwood. We are coming to you from the beautiful Auburn-Cord-Duesenberg Museum in Auburn, Indiana. On this trip, we explore 100 years of the automobile in Indiana. Yep, 100 years ago, July 4th, 1894 to be exact, the multi-talented Elwood Haynes steered his way into automotive history when he navigated his Pioneer along a dusty road on the south side of Kokomo, Indiana. Titus Rush has more on this remarkable Hoosier.
Who would have thought that this four-year-old kid would have amounted to anything other than a well-to-do Jay County school teacher?
It was about the time of the Civil War, back in 1857, that Elwood Haynes was born, the fifth child of Jacob and Helinda Haynes. Jacob was a well-respected attorney and imputed the highest moral values to his children. Elwood, or Wood as he was called, grew up wandering the surrounds of rural, unsophisticated Portland, Indiana. That's where he discovered his lifelong passion.
Metallurgy, chemistry. That's why I called my book Alloys and Automobiles. The first entry was alloys.
According to Gray's book on the Hoosier inventor, Haynes was a tinkerer who loved chemistry. His life lacked focus. However, that was something he obtained in college.
He went to college at Worcester, what became Worcester Polytechnic Institute in Worcester, Massachusetts. And he's the oldest guy in the class. He was, I say, slow, you know, but he was very popular and worked very hard.
In 1881, Haynes graduated, and once back in Portland, he engaged in what probably under normal circumstances would have become his lifelong profession. He became a teacher. But something was discovered which changed his life.
Natural gas was discovered in 1886. He's right in the right place at the right time. See, it's just great.
The beckoning call of Indiana's oil and gas boom unleashed Haynes' creative genius. As superintendent of the Portland, Indiana Gas Company, Haynes, in order to keep the lines from freezing, created a method of dehydrating natural gas. It was during this time that Haynes got the idea of developing a mechanical means of transportation.
When he went to the Chicago World Fair in 1893, he saw a gasoline engine. Said that might work in my little vehicle. It was used for boats up to that time. So he bought the engine and brought it to Kokomo.
Haynes hired the Apperson brothers, Edgar and Elmer of the Riverside Machine Works, to build his first car. On July 4, 1894, the Haynes Pioneer made its first successful run on the outskirts of Kokomo along Pumpkin Vine Pike. The Haynes Pioneer was the second successful car built in America.
The first one in the nation was probably the Duryea's in Massachusetts by a very small margin. They built a car also in 93 to 94. They tested one in September 93. It ran about 100 yards and stopped, so I don't call that success. They had to go back to the shop and try it again in January of 94, so then it worked.
For a short time, Haynes and the Appersons produced automobiles together, but after a few years, they went their separate ways. The Haynes Automobile Company flourished for nearly a quarter of a century, and as one might expect, his inventiveness was reflected in the product.
This is our 1905 Haynes Model L. It's 11 years later than the first one. It's got gasoline power too. It has a tilt steering wheel, which was a Haynes invention. there was no age limit at that time, so he made it so it would adjust to anyone to drive. It has a two-cylinder engine with a posed piston. His first engine ran very rough because it had a one-piston engine, so he put these horizontally in the engine instead of vertically and opposed them toward each other. And it made this car the smoothest running car of its time. It also has a semi-automatic transmission, which put it way ahead of its time.
The automobile notwithstanding, the Hoosier inventor's first love was metallurgy. He invented stainless steel and one of the hardest substances known to man, an alloy called stellite.
It's used in piston rings, anywhere where it needs to be friction resistant, heat resistant.
The recession of the 1920s wreaked havoc on the Hoosier auto industry. Haynes pulled money from his stellite company to pay back investors in his automobiles. But the company failed in 1925, and not long thereafter, Haynes was gone too. Elwood Haynes died here in April of 1925, some say from the stress to maintain the very things he invented. Inventions which will keep his memory alive forever.
Some called him Indiana's P.T. Barnum. Others just said he was crazy. Carl Fisher was nuts about a new invention, the car. That's coming up a little bit later in the show. E.L. Cord wanted the best for his burgeoning automobile company in tiny Auburn, Indiana. He hired noted Fort Wayne architect A.M. Strauss to design and build a new administration center in the trendy Art Deco design. The local townspeople thought it too large, too extravagant for a humble Hoosier town. But what was once the company's showroom when it opened in 1930 is now a showcase for legendary automobiles, the Auburn-Cord-Duesenberg Museum. And this tiny Hoosier town now hangs its hat on it. The automobile showcased in the Auburn-Cord-Duesenberg Museum are from what is probably the most glorious era in Indiana automobile manufacturing. And joining us now to discuss those glory days is Matt Short, the curator for the Auburn-Cord-Duesenberg Museum. Matt, thanks for going across Indiana with us.
You're very welcome.
Now, what was so special really about this era, the 20s and 30s? What really set it apart from the rest of Indiana's automotive history?
Well, here, the Auburns, Cords, and Duesenbergs were at the forefront of styling in terms of the industry. Both in terms of technological advancements and just the beauty of the bodies.
And what we're really talking in technological advancements, innovations that had never been seen before, which today are standard on many cars.
Absolutely. The Model J Duesenberg was the highest horsepower production car in the world at 265 horsepower. This Cord that we're sitting in here is a supercharged 8-cylinder at 170 horsepower. So they're very fast, very powerful, and very luxurious automobiles.
So what was it about really the Indiana's angle on automobile manufacturing? Because we saw in the Detroit and like the Fords going for a mass-produced car for every consumer, these cars were very special cars for a kind of an elite type of a person.
Right. The automotive builders in Indiana really couldn't compete on, you know, building a million cars a year. So they had to be different. They had to set themselves apart. And they did this through styling and engineering advancements.
And again, just talk about some of the automobiles, the very special automobiles that we see here.
Okay. This is a 1937 812 Cord that we're sitting in. When the vehicle was introduced at the 1935 automobile show in New York, people stood on other cars to get a look at this one because it was such a striking difference from anything else being produced. The car featured, had 30 different features that were unique to the car and became standards in the industry, like no running boards and fold-down headlights and a radio as standard equipment.
This had the first retractable headlights.
Right, the first retractable headlights in the industry in a 1936 Cord.
What were really the economic forces that I guess signaled the end for this era in Indiana's automobile manufacturing?
Well, the cars were very labor-intensive because of all the hand craftsmanship that went into them, so cost was a big factor. And also, in the height of the Depression, it wasn't very fashionable to spend anywhere from $3,000 to $20,000 on an automobile. It just wasn't good form.
So what, when you walk through this museum, I mean, what, describe a little bit the feelings, and does it take you back to that era, and what do you feel?
It really does. We're in the Auburn Automobile Company factory showroom, and this is where dealers came to view the new products. And the showroom is currently set up much the way that it was at that time. You saw all the new automobiles that the company was producing. In other parts of the museum are the design studios, the administrative offices, sales offices, and the engineering wing.
So you've really recreated a bit of Indiana history right here in this museum.
Absolutely, and the museum is unique in the world. We are in the only factory showroom in the world.
That's great. Matt Short, thanks so much for going to Across Indiana with us.
You're welcome.
This special edition of Across Indiana is brought to you by the town of DeSoto, Indiana.
Approximately 75 miles due south of Auburn, where the DeSoto automobile was made, lies a town of the same name. But Across Indiana was discouraged when we found out that DeSoto, Indiana was named for the Spanish explorer and not for this 1931 four-door sedan. But we were still curious as to what the people of DeSoto were driving these days and took a tour through town. There was the usual selection of American makes, Plymouth, Chevy, Dodge, Lincoln, and a faded red Ford van. How many Little Leaguers do you think this thing took to the Pizza Hut over the years? We did find a couple of foreign jobbies, including a Mazda and this beauty up on blocks. We're TV producers, not certified mechanics, but ma'am, that looks like a problem with your differential. It's fitting that DeSoto, the town, has no connection with DeSoto, the car. The Chrysler-built DeSoto that most people are familiar with has no connection with the car of the same name built in Auburn from 1913 to 1914. Apparently, the Detroit auto giant, like the town, thought it was a pretty sounding name. DeSoto, Indiana, named for the Spanish explorer, not a car, but still an appropriate sponsor of this special auto edition of Across Indiana. If you'd like your small town to sponsor an episode of Across Indiana, then write to us in care of WFYI Television, 1401 North Meridian Street, Indianapolis, Indiana, 46202. We'd like to hear from a Ferrari, Indiana. We heard that DeLorean, Indiana is pretty much a ghost town these days.
Across Indiana, sponsored by DeSoto. Our hospitality is a standard feature. Some dealer restrictions may apply.
The Senator, built in Ridgeville, Indiana from 1906 to 1912, had a tonneau as one of its features. A rather plush rear seat, it alarmed some social-minded Puritans, including a judge in Muncie who proclaimed that the automobile was nothing but a house of prostitution on wheels. Well, the automobile became many things, but never a brothelmobile. However, Across Indiana would personally like to thank the Hoosier-built Senator for spawning Love in the Back Seat, the car date, and for giving us an added reason to visit the drive-in. Standing among so many beautiful autos, like this 1935 Auburn Boattail Speedster, you really get a feel for the integrity and craftsmanship of Hoosier automakers. But these stylish cars are really just the tip of the automotive iceberg when it comes to automaking in Indiana. Producer J. Robert Cook takes a brief look at a very long and colorful history of automobile manufacturing in the Hoosier State.
Ask most people who invented the automobile, and they'd say Henry Ford. But as most Hoosiers know, Elwood Haynes of Kokomo took to the dusty roads of the Pumpkin Vine Pike in a horseless carriage of his own design in 1894, 2 years before Mr. Ford traveled down the streets of Detroit. In fact, for the first few decades of the automotive era, Indiana gave Detroit a pretty good run for the honor of being the automotive capital of the country. Over the last 100 years, Indiana has been home to over 500 different manufacturers of automobiles in a wide range of design and function. And while many cars were made in the larger industrial centers such as Indianapolis, Evansville, or South Bend, many more were the products of the small town and alleyway mechanics of the Hoosier State. Take, for example, the Lexington, a classy touring car manufactured in Connersville from 1910 to 1927, or the Durant, a sensible touring car made in Muncie in the 1920s. Nearly everyone has heard of the Stutz Bearcat, but did you know the Bearcat was only one of several models from the Stutz Motor Car Company of Indianapolis until its demise in 1935? Another Indianapolis creation was the Roosevelt, named not for Franklin, but for Teddy. It was around between 1929 and 30. If you were in the market for something unusual, you might have considered the Imp, a cycle car made in Auburn between 1914 and 15. A cycle car was a kind of half motorcycle, half auto, with a chain drive for power. Besides the Imp, there was also the Reel, made in Converse around the same time, and the Redbug from Lafayette for the young motorist in all of us. The city of Auburn played an important part in Indiana's motorized history. It was home to a number of automobile makers, including Kiblinger, Zimmerman, and of course, Auburn and Cord. According to a list compiled by American Heritage Magazine of the 10 greatest automobiles ever made, four came from Indiana in the 1930s. And one of those, the 1937 Cord 812, was an Auburn native. The other three on the list were a Stutz, a Duesenberg, and a Marmon, all from Indianapolis. 500 race fans should recognize the Marmon. It was the Marmon Wasp that won the first 500 in 1911. Sometimes the name says it all. The Huntingburg was a product of, naturally, Huntingburg, while the Lafayette, strangely, came from Indianapolis. Some Indiana cars developed a certain notoriety of their own. Remember Jack Benny and his old rattletrap of a car? Well, Mr. Benny's Maxwell was a Hoosier creation from Newcastle, where it was made from 1906 to 1924. Columbus was the home to two amazing cars, the 1912 Reeves Octa Auto, named for obvious reasons, and its smaller sister, the Secta Auto. The company claimed the extra wheels added stability. Elkhart was home to a number of fine automobiles, including the Elk Car, the Marathon, and the Pratt Electric. Richmond had the Pilot, while Peru could boast of the Bryant Steamer from the Bryant Boiler Company. Another early entrant on the automotive scene was the Vanel Steam Carriage, made in Vincennes in 1894 and 95. Then there was the Henderson, a kerosene-burning touring car that boasted 20 miles to the gallon. And of course, no list of Indiana automobiles could be complete without the mention of Studebaker of South Bend, whose Avante of the early 60s is still regarded as a classic. Then there was the Pope Waverly Electric. The company motto was, "The name bespeaks the quality." The Meyer Carriage and Buggy Company of Ligonier made a brief entrance into the horseless carriage era with this 1908 speedster. 1910 saw the Clark take to the streets of Shelbyville. The Postal was the pride of the Postal Auto and Engine Company. It rolled off the line in Bedford in 1907. And finally, not to let you think that auto making is a thing of the past in Indiana, meet the Hummer, the hottest new off-road four-wheel drive you can find this side of Desert Storm. It's the creation of AM General of South Bend and the latest in a long line of vehicles that can proudly be stamped made in Indiana.
Not far from Auburn in Fort Wayne are the remnants of this country's first transcontinental highway, the Lincoln Highway. What good is an automobile if there aren't any decent roads to drive them on, and practically no roads out west? That was the problem facing a country looking to take their new automobiles on the open road. Hoosier auto pioneers Carl Fisher and Henry Osterman were both beneficial in getting this country's first coast-to-coast road built. Ironically, Osterman died while traveling on the Lincoln Highway. becoming one of this country's first highway statistics. When it came to transportation, there was a time when all a person had to worry about was a good set of horseshoes and a bridle. But when the horseless carriage showed up, suddenly there were pistons, push rods, valve stems, crankshafts, and a whole assortment of whirling thingamabobs and reciprocating whatchamacallits. Obviously, it was going to take a lot to push this heap of technology on the local farmer. Leave it to a Hoosier, Carl Fisher, to do just that. He was the consummate salesman, a promoter, an idea man. And as producer Dave Stelk tells us, Carl Fisher was more likely to engineer a fraternity prank than one of those newfangled automobiles.
So I've done a variety of stunts. I'd say the most dangerous stunt I've ever done was the train escape.
Indianapolis broadcaster and media executive Bill Shirk goes to great lengths to promote his business ventures. Some call him Crazy Bill Shirk.
Crazy Bill Shirk!
I've been described many times as, yeah, he's crazy, crazy like a fox. And I set the world record for getting out of a straitjacket hanging beneath a helicopter at 1,800 feet in the air.
100 years ago, people were saying that about another Indianapolis businessman.
That's right. He was known as, through all his promotional stunts, as Crazy Carl Fisher, and some people thought he was crazy. He was really certifiable and should be put away.
But today, historians, as well as modern promoters like Bill Shirk, have since seen the method behind Fisher's madness.
And to even conceive of the idea of being in a car below a balloon and to be able to visualize something that nobody else would ever dream of doing, probably never even visualize doing, but yet visualize it, say you're going to do it, and then do it.
His vision would define his existence and be his legacy. Carl G. Fisher was born in 1874 in Greensburg, Indiana, and suffered from astigmatism, a condition that left him with very poor eyesight, which deteriorated the rest of his life. But Fisher saw something at the turn of the century that others couldn't see.
When automobiles first came out, there were, you know, these newfangled contraptions, the horseless carriage. They frightened horses. They ran things off the road. And it took some convincing to get people, keep people's minds on this new toy, that consider it as a reliable form of transportation.
Most people at the time dismissed it as a toy. In Fisher's eye, the automobile was a necessity. The young Fisher had already made a name for himself by promoting another type of wheel, the bicycle. He was known for his publicity stunts, which included throwing a bicycle off of the tallest building in Indianapolis. The person who retrieved it brought it to his shop to receive a free bike. I don't see why the automobile can't be made to do everything the bicycle has done, said Fisher, and converted his bike shop into a car sales and repair facility. Only instead of a bike frame, he dumped a car over the side of a seven-story building. It was also about this time that Carl dreamed up the balloon stunt. Crazy Carl Fisher and the zany automobile were all over the newspapers. Once someone asked him how he managed to get so much free publicity, Carl grinned, "Because I can't afford to pay for it."
Yeah, he was an event creator. He got himself in the newspapers. He was a genius at that. He didn't need a PR man. He was his own PR man.
It was estimated that this one stunt received more than 12 million printed lines worldwide and at least $1 million worth of publicity. And it wasn't long before Carl was making millions. Then Fisher had another one of his crazy visions, this time in a cornfield on the west side of Indianapolis. He wanted to build an oval, a proving ground to test the American automobile and, quote, the finest racetrack in the world, he told his lifelong friend, Jim Allison, along with business partners Arthur Newby and Frank Wheeler.
And he used his promotional genius to get people in, to come out to the speedway as he did in selling cars. The first really activity on the speedway was some balloon races.
He even tried motorcycle races, and after a couple of rough auto races, Fisher convinced his partners to improve the track by paving it entirely with brick. Another crazy idea. The first 500-mile race was held May 30th, 1911, when Fisher first envisioned the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. There was again talk of Crazy Carl, and people openly questioned who would travel 15 miles outside of Indianapolis to watch a race in the middle of a cornfield. Jane Fisher said of her husband Carl, everything he did stemmed from his passion for automobiles, which is why he pushed for decent roads and the construction of America's first coast-to-coast highway, the Lincoln Highway. He staged a publicity tour, of course. He even gave us a place to drive to, a getaway. What those crazy eyes of Fisher saw amidst this South Florida jungle was Miami Beach. He developed it, and in Fisher style, literally sold America a swamp in what's been called the greatest publicity campaign in history. Fisher often said he hoped he would live to see the day when every family in America owned a car. And that was often quoted as proof of Carl's foolish faith in the future of the automobile. After several failed investments and a bout with alcohol, Carl Fisher died penniless in 1939. But they say Carl Fisher never stopped dreaming, and the man whose sight had failed him in life somehow had fantastic vision that survives him in death.
If I could go back and talk to one gentleman, I think it would be him, because he was an entrepreneur. I mean, he started the 500 track. He was the visionary for that. Can you imagine the vision of it?
But Fisher, of course, could see things as they might be instead of as they were.
That about wraps it up for this very special edition of Across Indiana. Hope you enjoyed looking back on 100 years of automotive history in the Hoosier State. From the Auburn-Cord-Duesenberg Museum in Auburn, Indiana, I'm Michael Atwood. Hope to see you next week.
Financial support for this special edition of Across Indiana is generously provided by the Indiana Historical Society, an independent nonprofit organization offering a window into Indiana's past for more than 11,000 members, and by the Indianapolis Motor Speedway Hall of Fame Museum.